Thank you so much for sharing our sacred space here at the Bangalore Lit Fest. And we are most grateful to the organizers for inviting us and allowing us to be a part of the festival. So I'm going to share with you more my experience as the Anubhavi, the inner experiencer, not the outer experiencer. Most of us today are caught up in this outer experience. And today more than ever, the outer experience has, I would say as a woman, a little unsettling, if not angry. And I feel that angry women will take the world nowhere, except in their whirlpools of anger. So for a woman to be beautiful, harmonizing, blissful, calm, peaceful, is only when we find our swashakti, inner shakti, in our sthira, our steadfastness, silence. So instead of being angry, if we were just internalizing and moving into our silence, I think we would find more answers. And it's no doubt an honor to be here with Vamadevaji. As I say, today is also a very auspicious day. It's Karva Chauth. And I am keeping all the fasts. And someone even asked me that why should we fast for men? And it's not a question of fasting for men. It's a question of internalizing and working with my own shakti. And the man who protects me and allows me to move into the world and find my own expression, that's my way of honoring him. So it's not about my just fasting for a man and why I should or should not. It's also when I fast, it's an internalizing. And today is a busy day, so I'm not having any jal, no water. But, you know, my strength, inner strength, is pulling me through the day. Tonight we catch a flight to Jaipur. So it's a busy day. But the practice that I have been doing all these years has created that sthira, that strength, not only in my thoughts, but in the work I do. So that helps to answer some of the women who might be questioning that why would you need to fast, Shambhavi? It's for the happiness and peace of the family. And the man is an important part of the family because he's taking care of me. It's his hand on my shoulder and his protection. So unless I am not in harmony with that energy, then it is going to disrupt my own energies. So awakening the yoga shakti. The yoga shakti is that, again, the inner, deeper shakti. See, the audience doesn't have to tell me that I'm a strong woman. I'm an independent woman. I know I'm a strong woman. Because my inner strength allows me to express my freedom. I never have felt caged, nor by my spiritual practices, nor by the home, nor by the family. The family is protection for me. That's how I look at it. And today, I feel that there's a very fine line we are walking, is where they are trying to disrupt the family. In the West, we clearly see that there is no family and the woman is very vulnerable. So we should be very careful to protect that family system in our own dharmic cultures. Because when I'm alone and outside, I'm in isolation. And when I am in isolation, I'm almost an easier target. So if you want to instigate anger you will actually succeed in making me angry because I do not have the protection of the family to reason the logic of why am I angry. And being angry as a woman is going to take me nowhere. It's going to hurt my relationships. It's going to hurt the family. It's going to hurt the society. It's going to hurt the mind, the body, and the spirit. And that's why I feel, in fact, they had said I could even come alone. And I said, no, it would be nice to have Vamadeva ji, because it's nice also to have a man's perspective in the whole issue of the yoga shakti. So would you like to share something, Vamadeva?
I want to share something a little bit later. But first, I want to ask you the question that what is shakti? Mm-hmm. Because there's a lot of misunderstanding as to what shakti is. And how is true shakti gained? Is it through political rights, economic assertion, spiritual practices? What is this real shakti? Where does it come from? How can it be developed?
For me, shakti is auspicious. And the way I relate to shakti is going back to my true inner reality. And what is my reality? My reality is the union of my energies with the cosmic energies, which is Shakti. And how I explain Shakti is Bhu Devi, Mother Earth. See, a lot of us are so caught up in our personal, dramas that we think this is Shakti, this is my right. No, Shakti is Bhu Devi, Mother Earth. All the food, the gems, the water, the rivers that flow through her, that is Shakti. How many of us wake up every morning and before we place our foot on Mother Earth, how many of us really say a pranam? Very few hands up, no? So important. That's what is giving me another day of expression, another day of expressing my life. So when we wake up in the morning, we must draw our consciousness to our inner Shakti. And then Mahaprakriti. See, no matter what you and I are doing at this point of time, and at this point of time, a lot of us are very angry. But look at nature. No matter what we are doing, killing each other, hurting each other, harming each other, being mean. But nature never stops to give us flowers and fruits. And nature doesn't say only I can have the fruits and you can't have it, or only the Hindus can have it and not the Muslims, not the Christians. No. The fruit is for everybody. That is Shakti, the auspiciousness, the flow of divine grace. So when I begin to resonate with Mahaprakriti, Mother Nature, that becomes my Shakti, my inspiration. And then the light behind the cosmic heavens. In our busy lives, how many of us go out to meditate on that light? Very few. How many of us revere the moon? How many of us offer pranams, mantras, water with a little dash of milk? Today milk is banned. Why? We are saying not to have milk. We are telling women not to have milk. But milk is the most nurturing source of Shakti. So we sometimes get so caught in these outer manifestations of how the world is trying to instigate women, that we are falling into those whirlpools and finding it hard to keep our heads above the whirlpool. So for me, Shakti is auspicious. So only when I learn to resonate with the auspiciousness of Bhu Devi, Mahaprakriti, and the light of the cosmic heavens, do I find the stillness of my own Shakti, my inner Swa Shakti. And that is where sometimes spirituality helps. Having a sadhana, having a practice, cultivating rituals. See, rituals are very beautiful. They're not just... Today, we are even being attacked on our own rituals. But the rituals have a deeper meaning. When I am honoring the Devi in the temple, I'm honoring myself. When I'm offering her a diya, I am honoring and nurturing the fire, the agni within myself. When I am offering her the incense, the agarbatti, the dhoop, it's a cleansing for my complete energy and atmosphere. So for me, Shakti is moving, turning within and being in harmony and calmness with my inner self. That is the power of my Shakti. It's not about taking a flag, being angry, being rude, being crude. Shakti has no room for crudeness. Swashakti. The beauty of my inner being. So that's how we need to resonate and understand Shakti in today's world.
Yes. I have another kind of question for you. I know you've worked with many Western women, including who have been very successful, and even in their later years, 40s, 50s, and found this unhappiness and depression in them. And I know a lot of the women in India want to emulate those women.
The Western.
Yeah, and you can tell what they actually tell you that they feel.
You know, I just attended the yoga festival in Canada, and we had about 150 men and women, but there were more women. And I was supposed to speak on Shakti and world peace. So I just asked everybody, just look at each person sitting beside you. And I was studying everyone. Nobody could look at the person sitting right next to them. Some of them were giggling, some were laughing. And I said, here's world peace in this room. That if I cannot embrace and look at the person sitting next to me, how can I work for world peace? And then I said a very strong point, which is how I believe my Shakti works, is that we need to turn the finger inwards. And that works for all women. So when we talk about these nasty boys, men, you know, mean boys, men, or they're hurting us, or they are, you know, making us angry. I ask one simple question from every woman here, that all these boys and men have been brought up by some woman, correct? 99%. So where are we going wrong? Why are we creating these boys and men? What's happening with us? How can we blame them today? Something we are doing is not right. Because every boy and every man has been brought up in a household by women, mothers, sisters. So why should he go out and be mean and hurt another woman? All we women need to question ourselves, not question the men. That's another issue. Something we have done that is not quite right. In fact, we have encouraged these boys to be different, and we have let the girls believe that they are different. They aren't. Girls are brilliant, intelligent, beautiful, nurturing. But we as women need to teach the boys that it's not only to be nurturing with the women in the family, but when they step out of the home, they have to be nurturing with every woman. So this was how I explain to the Western woman, because most of our sadhaks are Western girls, and trust me, they're all very unhappy. The one thing they all want is a relationship. But it's the woman who holds, nurtures, and keeps the relationship. So when we begin to ask for our equality, we confuse the issues. Equality for what? I know my strength. I don't have to have Vamadevaji tell me that Shambhavi is a strong woman. He will tell you that if Shambhavi wants something, she'll get it. Very true. So I never for once say I'm a weak woman. But that doesn't have to make me angry, aggressive, abusive, crude. Not at all. Because I understand and I revere my Shakti. So that is a very important message for us today to take out into our society as well, because I feel that women here are also getting very angry.
And Shambhavi is someone who's had a lot of direct personal experiences of Devi in different forms. So I would like her to share some of her experiences of Devi, maybe Ma Kali or maybe Ma Durga, so that they can know that these are not just mythology. These are not just images. These are not just in the temples. These are the cosmic forces of the cosmic reality. It's we are in the shadows. These cosmic devis, divine forces are there. And in this Hindu tradition, we have the worship of all the forms of Shakti. We haven't restricted it in any way.
See, how I approach the Devi, again, is as nature. So most of my learning was done in nature. That when we are in sync with nature, then every flower becomes a Devi. The tree becomes Shiva. So when we move out into nature, we are able to bring alive the essence of the Devata.
Put it closer.
We are able to bring out the essence of the Devata and the Devi. And I think in every spiritual sampradaya, they do have the Shakti, the Devi. But most times we have kept her in the background. And nobody questions that. But in the Hindu thought, the Devi is the most important aspect of our worship. So we need to translate that same Devi energy into every woman that we find. In fact, you know, today, surprisingly, because it was Karva Chauth, and I was thinking what mantras or what should I do. And of all the Devis who came to me was Baglamukhi, and I don't do Baglamukhi sadhana at all. But Baglamukhi is there to protect. You see, so when the Devi comes, there's always a deeper message, a deeper mantra, a deeper reality. And the reason we have the different forms of the Dash Mahavidya is that these Devis are guiding us to the deeper essence. We are using the Devis more as an outer, you know, experience.
See, it's people have the idea that using these sadhanas mainly for outer things. But these sadhanas also have a much deeper meaning. In fact, yoga is the yoga shakti. In fact, people talk about yoga today, and they're involved with asanas and techniques. But there has to be an inspiration, an energy, a motivation. It's like art. You can teach people how to use paintbrushes and all of that, but there's no artistic inspiration. It's not going to go anywhere. So too, yoga has to be based upon awakening that yoga shakti, and that shakti shows the way. It's not going to follow a routine or other mechanical form. So you can explain that a little bit more, how the yoga shakti works within you?
See, as I said, when we internalize and come to our own sthira, see, most of us in life are unbalanced because we are not in our sthira shakti, the stillness. The stillness only comes when there's an inner silence. See, most times we are so caught up in the outer noise that we are unable to move into the intuitive higher voice. So when we silence our being, when we create the sthira in our muladhar, see, that's where we need to be grounded with Mother Earth. We need to be grounded with reality. We need to have a spiritual practice. We need to join the mantras because they create the vibrations. So when we join these factors, then it awakens the yoga shakti. So unless we do not have that inner stillness and peace, it's almost impossible to climb the spiritual ladder, because we begin to climb and then we short circuit because we are not in that stillness and we come down. And then we climb a few steps more and in time we get tired. But we are tired because to awaken the yoga shakti, we need to create the stillness and the sthira. I think we should open it up to questions.
Ramadev, yeah,
we
just
have
one more question
minutes.
For you. Just explain a little bit the role of mantra and yoga shakti.
See, for me, mantra is a cosmic sound. So it's a vibration, spand. So this being is also spand, vibration. So any sadhak who is clever will understand that I need to bring my vibration to coincide and correlate with the vibration of the universe. So mantras change my vibrations. And when my vibrations begin to resonate at the correct levels, then it is I'm able to tap into the magic of the cosmic universe. Trust me, the world is magical. I'm serious about this. The world for me is magical. Every day is magical. Why? Because I have learned to tap into the magic of the universe. So mantras help us to change our vibrations and to connect with the auspiciousness of the cosmic universe. So we're going to open it up to questions. I know you wanted to ask. Come. She wanted to ask a question in yoga, and we, you know, she didn't get a chance. You need to give her the mic better. You're busy on your cell phone, my dear. Come forward so everyone can see you're hiding behind the screen.
Okay, ma'am, my question is, I want you to give a right understanding on liberation and empowerment of women. So what is a right understanding of our empowerment of women and the liberation? So,
see, women were always empowered. You know, whether you look at the Hindu Dharma, all the devis in the temples, all the devis we pray to, they're all empowered. You look at our grandmothers and mothers, they had the tijori keys. That was an empowerment. There were difficulties, no doubt about it. Our grandmothers also had difficulties. Our mothers also struggled. But today, empowerment is not only about my rights. See, we are getting trapped in the Western concept of my right. And that is misguiding every woman today. It's about understanding my place in the universe. And when we get together, see, women are never together. You'll always find men coming together and even working together. Women rarely do that. They are the first ones to pull each other down, be nasty, be mean. So we women need to come together, but we need to come together in harmony and peace. This empowerment about anger, I totally disagree with. I definitely am an empowered woman in every way. I don't think I look angry. It's because I'm not angry. I don't need to be angry. And when I want to be heard, I will be heard. So empowerment is about protecting women, bringing women into their own, allowing women to blossom in every field and every phase of life. And whether we step out into the world to work, women still need protection. So the family is what protects us. You know, we go to office and there's so much of, you know, trials and tribulations, difficulties. But when we come home, the family nurtures us.
Hello, ma'am. The question I wanted to raise was, I think I'm a little confused about what kind of direction I would like to go to after your speech. At the first time, I was listening to how I agree with how women were always empowered in everything. But at the same time, when you talk about how women needs protection when it goes out, then how do I go about it, right? A and B, when you talk about how we have women always carried the tijori, right? But then you also need to remember that it was the same time when women also had the scars from domestic violence, the scars from every kind of societal manifestations. Mm-hmm. I just cannot name right now. So how do you see the dual nature of this, right?
Do you think the violence with the woman on the street and outside, the liberated woman, is any less? No. Not at all. No? So violence has always been there. And like I say, that if you're talking about men being violent, society being violent. So again, I think women need to play a major role there, because society is shaped and everyone is nurtured between the four walls by a woman. So I think we women need to take up these issues and make sure that there's equality between the boy and the girl in the family. The boy has to be taught to respect not only the women in the house, but even outside. And that when a man has grown up learning to respect and protect women, he will do that whether he's in office, whether he's a CEO, whether he's a director of a company. He will have the same principles, or he should. So this is where we women need to come together and reinforce that the world has to be a safer place for women. Agreed that in the olden days, though we had the keys to the tijori, there was some physical, you know, abuse. And but again, it's always, if you notice, the mother-in-law would always take the boy's side and never the girl's side. So who's to blame there? If my son was to ill-treat his wife, I would take the side of the girl, not his side. But we see that all mother-in-laws are protecting the boy, the son. This is a very simple example. So who's to blame there? The woman, because she's the mother, she needs to say, no, this is absolutely unpardonable behavior and disrespectful. So we women are our own biggest enemies sometimes. So it's only the women who will, I say, clearly, because I travel all over the world, if we want a happy, peaceful world, it will only come when women come together in harmony and peace and direct the flow of the river. It is only women, not men. But we need to be strong in an inner sense, not in this aggressive, fiery, angry, which the anger debilitates women. It disempowers us, my dear. It certainly doesn't empower us. Any other last question, I think?
You spoke about stillness and being in stillness. So could you give us a little guidance about how to go about?
See, stillness comes from a discipline, which is emotional, mental, a physical discipline. Sometimes we need to cultivate a sadhana or a spiritual practice. See, whether you go to school, there has to be discipline. If there wasn't discipline, all the children would be creating mayhem in the class. So discipline is very intrinsic to working towards creating that sthira or stillness. And when I rest in my own inner self, my own inner truth, then that initial wave of stillness is already there. I need to nurture that wave. So when I nurture that wave of stillness, it becomes into a lake, a pool, a soma pool. So either we can survive or live in a whirlpool where we are barely keeping our head above the waters, or we can create the soma lake. So I think stillness is going to be the key to any harmony and world peace today.